Ministries presents The Testimony of Jesus.
My name is Lazarus. It feels good to be alive. When I in chains on death was bound, this man named Jesus.
1 Peter 2:24. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, that we might die to sin and live unto righteousness. For by his stripes you were healed.
Living testimony of his death-defying touch. My name is Lazarus.
Join us as we witness this same Jesus as he transforms and restores lives today. Experience real passion for Jesus Christ.
Welcome to Healing Rooms Ministries, where the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. I'm Cal Pierce, director of Healing Rooms Ministries, and I'd like to welcome you to our program today. And today I have as my co-host, Linda Collins. Welcome, Linda.
Thank you.
Linda is one of our apostolic leaders in the ministry of Healing Rooms Ministries, and you do all of the travel arrangements.
Correct.
So you're sending me...
all over the world.
All over. Sending me to places that I've never been before, but... you do a good job of getting me out of town.
Thank you.
Well, we have today as our guest on the program, Randy Altmeyer. And Randy is one of the directors of Union Gospel Missions here in Spokane. And yeah. We'd like to welcome you to the program.
Welcome. Good to be here.
Yeah, good to have you here. How long have you been involved in Union Gospel Mission? Maybe tell... some of our viewers, you know, what is it all about? What do you do in a community like Spokane?
Well, my parents were involved in the mission after we were out of high school, and they were involved for about 12 years. And I have a brother and myself, and we've been involved. I've been there 22 years,
wow.
And he's been there about 20. So we have a little history.
Yes. Yeah, just a little. Wow. So you've seen a lot of people come through the mission.
Seen a lot of people come through, and I've seen a lot of changes. And when I think of changes, I think of when I came, the average age was 55, and now it's 28. So things have changed in 20 years.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow. That's interesting.
Tell us a little bit about who your guests are that come to the mission.
Well, as a mission, we're open for people that when you think of us, you think of people off of the street. But we have people that come from churches. We have people that come from families. We have, just like the other day, we have a mother that sends down her son because she wants him to be aware of what alcohol is going to do in his life because he's been out partying. So we take in a wide group of people that come our way.
Uh-huh.
So even though when you think of a mission, you think of people on the streets, and that's the majority of them, we do cater to a lot of other people that come our way.
Now they stay there?
They can do a little bit of everything. We have uh-huh. meals for people that just want to come in for the evening. We have a guest for those that are, we call them guests that come in and stay overnight. And then we have a program for people that come in that really want to change their lives. And we like to see them commit to at least about 15 months to work a program so that we can not only get their life changed around, but get them jobs and get them back out in society to be productive.
Yes. Now, you mentioned about the age difference now. You know, tell me a little bit about what you're sensing from a standpoint of society, I guess I might say, as far as, why is that difference? Why is it getting younger?
Well, that's a good question, because like when my dad and I first came, the person that would be the typical person that would come off the street would be what we would call the black sheep of the family. He'd be one that had some education, came from a religious background, but just kind of turned his back on the Lord and decided to go in a different direction. But today things are so different because we have so many young people coming because divorce is on the uprise. Yes. Kids are not parented. They're living with other people all the time. So I say what we've become in a lot of ways is like foster parents to mm-hmm. a lot of kids that come our way. So mm-hmm. you see such a radical change because society has changed. And that's why the age continually comes down. So the people we come in with today don't have the skills, they're not necessarily the transient type that goes from one city to another city looking for jobs or fruit picking like we used to see.
Yeah.
But more just coming in because they've been rejected and don't have a place to go. There isn't a home for them. And so we see more of this today than we ever have before.
Mm. Yeah, and we do see that too in Healing Rooms.
We do.
Because, you know, these same people can come for prayer for addiction or physical problems. And, you know, we do see an attack against the family, especially in America. Mm-hmm. You know, and I suppose it's the same way in other countries. And it's that breakdown that causes people to sort of be like an orphan. They have the spirit of an orphan, really, because of rejection, abuse, abandonment, mm-hmm. and those issues cause trauma in the heart of the man or woman, and there needs to be healing there.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, and we've seen and also heard that this is probably the most fatherless generation of all time.
Yeah, mm-hmm. yes.
And without that father and the father's love in the home, that system is breaking down,
mm-hmm.
that family unit.
I might just add to this, one of the courses that I teach is a book on false intimacy. And as I sit down, and I've probably had at this point in time four or five different classes since we've done this class, and one of the questions I always ask them is, how were you taught about sex? Was somebody able to teach you or speak into your life or show you a proper way? And I've yet to see in all these classes, only one person had somebody. It wasn't their parents. Mm-hmm. So it just gives you an idea out of 25 to 30 people that I've asked specifically about that, where we're at and as a generation, where we've come from,
right.
and where we're going.
So without a father and a mother to raise up the child as they should go, then without that raising, they have misconceptions of what's a normal life to look like.
Correct.
So that relates obviously in their conduct, and then they become homeless. I'm assuming most of these people are they homeless?
Yeah, you know, people will ask me, that's a very typical question, why do you have certain people that come in and why are they the way they are? And I've come up with an answer over the years to just say, you know, people just aren't able, some of them, to cope with things that have happened in life. And when I say that, a lot of people realize how close they are, even as Christians or with a good background of having things come into their life where they were so discouraged and they were barely able to cope with it. And so they turn to different things because of the deep woundedness, to cover up those deep wounds that happen in life. And those wounds can be from losing a job to a kid, to a parent, to a wife, you know, all those abandonment issues that come in. And when we have no one to turn to and we don't know Jesus, we go to these addictions.
So they're not bad people, they're just good people that have had bad experiences.
Right.
Yes.
And that's caused trauma and turmoil, mm-hmm. and it's the healing process that that you're bringing them into that's bringing deliverance to them.
Yeah, right.
Now what other kinds of programs do you have at the mission?
Well, the program that we run right now is really what we call a grace-based program. And I think it's been so easy for us as missions over the years to get involved in what I call programs that are kind of checking the boxes. And we go in and we have them go through certain programs, complete certain courses and do certain things. And we've seen good things come out of that. But one of the things that we're focusing more on than ever is to look at the heart. Mm-hmm. And we have what we call self-evaluations that we work with our individuals so that they can get up and go through a series of questions to examine what's really going on with me and why did I do what I did and where is that coming from. And so we've been involved in this particular program for about 2 years and we've really seen some great results as far as people really looking inside instead of coming in and trying to figure out what do I need to do to get through this program and look good. And that's a battle we all deal with.
Yeah, because the Bible talks about not just having knowledge, but having knowledge produce understanding. And mm-hmm, I can see where that understanding gives them what they need to know to move out of where they're at. Mm-hmm. You know, and it's all about getting delivered from what has held you down and held you back.
And when you don't have a family, you learn to try and please people to be accepted, and you become rather good at it. You become an enabler. You become different things so that you can please people instead of getting to the wounds and the hurts and the things that are really going on. So those are big areas and issues we try to work with and get to.
Yes, yes. Now, what other type of things does the mission do?
Well, one of the things that I'm involved in right now is called Celebrate Recovery. And this is a program that I got involved in with a couple other pastors in the town, which kind of evolves around the 12 steps and comes out of Saddleback, California. And so we have a community Bible, and Mount Spokane are two different churches that are involved in doing this program. And so one of the things that kind of brings us to where we're at now is that we have a Monday night service. They do 12-step groups, and they come and do that on Monday night. And we do Monday night at the mission a little bit more of a service type for those that are a little bit more interested in spiritual things. Mm-hmm. And that kind of brings us around a little bit to where the Healing Rooms have become involved in our ministry.
Yes, yes. So you've opened a healing room there.
Yeah, and here's kind of how it happened. I had a man on our program that goes to your church right here, Henry Ewall, and he was on our program.
Yes,
and
yes.
What we try to do on our program is get people to get involved in churches outside of the mission, and he got involved in the healing rooms, him and another guy by the name of Frank. And they would come back and tell me what's going on, and we got to build quite a relationship. And so I told him one of the things I'd always had a desire for was to get people to come and pray for us. Mm-hmm. And so that started a journey of us talking about that, and that started a journey of him getting involved with Stacia and coming down to the ministry and sharing with me what the Healing Rooms was about and what they did and how they prayed for people. Uh-huh. And I have to tell you, the thing that I was really impressed with was the fact that they came down and wanted to be servants at the mission, not just come down and be those that would pray and need a time and a room and things, but I was overwhelmed by their attitude. And so we have been in a journey that has now involved two separate groups that come down. And so on Monday nights when we have the service, we have two rooms that are open for people, and they meet probably with about 8 to 10 people every evening, and that involves probably 20 minutes to 30 minutes per person. Mm-hmm. And the people I deal with, that we deal with at the mission, man, this is such a healing thing, because we talk about it so much. In order to get inside someone, you have to build a relationship with them. And so it's been neat for me to watch these people from the Healing Rooms come down, be consistent, be there all the time, week after week, and build these relationships, and then watch the people respond to them.
Yeah, and just open up to the... Yeah, because sometimes when you have injury or hurt, you have a tendency to close yourself off.
You do.
And then you're not approachable. And I suppose that is because, you know, if you open yourself up, then you're exposed again for more hurt. And that's the perception that we see that people that come into the Healing Rooms have quite often.
And when you're dealing with people that have been wounded and had people abandon them, they're always given promises. And I remember one of the criteria I had is, before you start the Healing Rooms, I would like you people to come down for just a couple of weeks and sit in the service so that these people can see that you're going to be here to stay. You're not just going to show up
Correct.
And tell them you want to pray for them, but you're going to be here and you're going to be consistent. And as they see that, a lot of times when they come into the Healing Room, you know, they're building a relationship. So they come in and let the walls down or peel the onion, and they let them come in further each and every time that they are meet with them. And so it's a building relationship, and I think that's what they enjoy about coming down, is they get to be like a parent to them. Sure. They get to be involved with them like a children would with their parent. And so the walls come down and the people open up a little bit more. So then we can work on the deep wounds and get more to the inner healing.
Yeah, yeah, go after the heart. You know, it's just so neat to see that, to see the, you know, here at our international office where we have healing rooms, we don't have that opportunity to build the relationship because we have so many people coming, you know, 1,000 mm-hmm. people a month, and they may come consistently over a period of time, and then other people may not. But at the mission, it's a different scenario, you know, because of that injury and what's happened and the trauma that's in these people's lives. So you need to have that building of the relationship,
yeah,
just because of the abandonment. And like we said, people get closed off and they have to open up to get healed, you know.
Back to this Monday night service, excuse me.
Sure.
Are the guests men, women, and young people, just like we were talking earlier, or is it pretty much the men on Monday nights? What's our combination?
Yeah, that's a good question, Linda. What's a little different about Monday night is because it's Celebrate Recovery. So this is people that come from Celebrate Recovery.
Okay.
This is people that come from the mission. This is people that come from our new women's shelter crisis that we just opened here about 3 months ago.
Yeah. Yeah.
So we have, it's not just a men's night like usually we have. And so we have probably at least 50% women, plus we have children down there.
Mm-hmm.
And so the last few months, we've had more kids than ever, and so we've had up to 20-25 kids. So it's kind of like a family night at church. And so this particular evening, we're reaching out to more in the community, more Celebrate Recovery people, more mission people. So it's a little different than the typical evening service.
What about are children being ministered to by the healing rooms at this point, or will they in the future have opportunity if the parent is there?
Usually that can happen.
Okay.
And it has happened in some demonic cases where we've dealt with that, where we've had the kids come in and want to be prayed for. But the majority of the time it's for the parents that are coming in, and we're trying to provide an arena for the kids to be, because a lot of the parents need to be in here, need to hear the gospel, need to be encouraged because they're struggling with so many things. So that's kind of where we're at this point in time.
Great.
It's exciting to see. Of course, the title of our program here is The Testimony of Jesus.
Right.
And that's what is exciting about the fruit of the work of the ministry is the testimonies of transformed lives like Henry, you know, because that's God's goal. You know, the enemy's goal is to steal our destiny. But, you know, Henry, here's a man who came to the mission and you folks worked with him and God raised him up and then he's starting to just blossom, you know, into ministry and reaching out to others, you know, and that's what it's all about.
Well, and he's on staff now.
Yeah, that's right.
Functioning in the community,
yeah.
Advancing the kingdom of God.
Yeah, yeah. And working here at our international office,
yes.
And praying in the healing rooms at the mission. I mean, that's exciting.
Mm-hmm. I would probably say two testimonies are a little different for us down there because the testimonies that women will share are about CPS. They'll stand up in front of everybody and talk about, I just got my kids back, or I'm getting
yes.
my kids back, or we'll see them break down and just share sometimes about abuse and things like that. So we get to see some neat things that happen.
Yes.
But you know, it is such a neat thing to see as the scripture talks about how they overcame the enemy by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimonies.
Yes.
And we do on Monday nights take about 15 minutes where we have times where we just go around and hear the testimonies of what's happening and how long they've been sober, how long they've been off drugs, and that's our hallelujah times where we just kind of give the Lord a hand for his goodness. So we see a little bit different type of results, and we see people share things that are a little different than you would sometimes in a typical church.
Well, but that's the progress that God builds people into. As far as it's like, I always see that as like a set of stairs. You know, right. Every step you take, the higher you go. So as they share the testimony, it's a prophecy of what Jesus is doing in their life as an encouragement to those that are around them that also need to come up to that level. And it's a journey, not a destination, you know, and it's a journey that these folks are going through. And, you know, it's touching their heart, you know, and they're sharing from their heart that, hey, because before they had none. They had no testimony. It was just what the enemy had done to devastate a life.
Yeah.
And now we're seeing what Jesus does to restore a life.
And then too, Cal, one of the things that I would want to share with you that I think is a tribute to the healing rooms is people go in and they get prayed for. And God sets them free. He delivers them. He gets them jobs. They have inner healing. Then they get to come back out and share that in a testimony of how Christ has delivered them or what they have worked through. And it's not just God touching them and delivering them, but it's also building a relationship with people in the healing rooms. And I think that's one of the things that, they enjoy coming down and doing. And it allows people to see, you know, God is really a God about prayer. And when we spend time and we're diligent before Him and when we pray and seek His face, He does some neat things. That's and so right. They get to be a part of that and share that, and that becomes a part of their life.
Yeah. We're a family.
Well, and that's what I want to say. You know, you were thanking us and sharing your appreciation. But you know what? When ministries come together, like the Ministry of the Union Gospel Mission and the Women's Shelter and Ogden and the Healing Rooms and churches in a city, we're going to see cities transformed. There is a teamwork. There's this relationship that you've talked about. And when people that have been abused in relationship not only see the people at Union Gospel Mission or Healing Rooms, but they begin to see us working together, that is a display of unity.
Yes, it is.
And they want to be a part of something that's a family relationship.
Yeah, we can do more together.
Right.
Right.
You know,
as we move in unity, because unity brings power.
Right.
You know, I'll never forget this example that a farmer in Canada had given about how important it is to pull together into a mission that God gives us. And what he did is he hooked up a draft horse to a sled with weight on it. And one draft horse pulled like 9,500 pounds. The other one pulled like 9,400 pounds. But then he hooked the two horses together and loaded 30,000 pounds on the sled. And in the unity, they could pull the 30,000 pounds.
Yeah.
You know, and that's what we do as the body of Christ when ministries work together to impact one city through the power of one God in unity, they move in power, a greater power than they could do individually.
Our capacities increase, that synergy.
That's right.
Yeah. One of the things I like to share with the people, as I said, you guys have an opportunity to see 3 and 4 ministries come together on one evening, where you don't get to see that a lot of times in a local church because it's focused on that ministry. Mm-hmm. So they get to see the ministry of the Union Gospel Mission. They get to see Mount Spokane. They get to see Celebrate Recovery because they come in too with their worship bands. The Healing Rooms come in. And so we get to see, and they get to see that happen. And I really believe, and I know you believe this too, that that's what God wants to do in these end times, is He wants to bring us together, bring the walls down, not look at the things that we've often thought cause division, but to see what we have in common.
Correct.
And for these people to see that is huge because they haven't seen that in their life. Yeah. And to see people get up and love one another and joke with one another and be on the other side as far as a person being in this camp and one being in this camp, and yet we come together and love one another and work together and pray together, that's what it's all about.
Well, you can only accomplish that when your heart is and your life is given to the broken who need to be healed and touched. And that needs to be more important than our agendas so that we can come together on their behalf. And that's what Jesus wants His body to do.
Yeah.
And it's so exciting to see that, begin to happen. And that needs to happen in cities all over the world.
Right,
you know,
right.
The only limitations that God has is us, you know.
Yeah.
And so when we learn how to pull together, we can do a whole lot more to transform lives and see cities impacted by this kingdom message that Jesus brought us.
Right. He says, let the whole earth be filled with his glory.
Yes.
And this is where it starts. A scripture that I looked up, it says, thou shalt open your hand unto thy brother and unto the poor and the needy in the land.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what you've done.
Yeah, yeah.
And you've allowed us to be a part of it, and we say thank you.
Yes, yes. It's been a tremendous blessing just to do that and see the increase that is coming through working together as a body of Christ.
Yes.
You know, and having a heater room at Union Gospel Mission. And but, you know, I think the key to opening the door to unity is servanthood, like Randy said. You know, we encourage our people to, you know, go there and just serve. Just go there and let the heart of Jesus reach out to the hurting and have that as your focus, and it'll work. You know, it'll work because it's not about us. It's about him.
Mm-hmm.
It's about what Jesus can do in the hearts and lives of hurting people. And, you know, it's exciting to just be able to play a part in that.
Well, it's so joyful. This is what we're created to do.
Yeah, yeah. And we're brothers and sisters in this great harvest time that God is moving us towards. And, you know, what an awesome hour we live in, you know. And we're just starting to rise up into the fullness of a great revival so that we can take a harvest and have a wedding. We need to have a wedding. And I think this is part of the preparation.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I don't know that we've been in a time in history where we've come together like we have now. So we've only got a little bit of time left, but we want to encourage all of those that are watching the program today. If you've watched it and you have a heart to reach out to somebody, you know, just remember that the hurting, the sick, the lost are worth our life. And I believe that's the key, is learning how to give what you have for them so that they can come into not just the saving grace of what Jesus has, but to be healed in their heart. God wants to release the destiny in the body of Christ all over the world. And when we come together as the body of Christ, destiny can come into the hurting. So we just want to bless you. If you need to get a hold of us, there will be some information on the website. So God bless you and have a great day. Bye-bye.
This man named Jesus called me out. If you think your little problem is too big for him to solve.